Yeah, hi. Good morning, guys. Thank you, Harish, for the wonderful talk. I mean, it was a very good perspective on all the back-end stuff that went in building this product. I'm Rajesh. I'm the product manager for FreeCharge.in, and I'm currently looking at the website. Previously, I worked with sites like Redbus, BookMyShow, and Rediff.com, so pretty much built a lot of Redbus and BookMyShow. I tweeted fart-free, so if you want any feedback, please... fart freely. So, that's it. So, I'm going to talk about, how to make a minimum viable product viable. Now, when we say a minimum viable product, a lot of different thoughts come to our minds, right? What do you mean by minimum viable product? How much is viable? Should I actually cut down everything and build only one or two things? So, there are a lot of questions that come to our mind. And at the end, we don't really know if this is going to work for our customers or not. So, over the period of next 30 minutes, I'm going to try and share some interesting learnings that I've had over the past 9 or 10 years building products in the country, and also give you a little peek on how we actually, you saw the different transitions of FreeCharge.in website. So I'll give you some insights on how we actually reached there and other decisions that we took, right? So obviously the first thing you would want, you might want to ask is, what is a minimum viable product? Before I start, how many people here are working in a startup or a entrepreneurs? Oh, a lot of people. How many people are aspiring entrepreneurs? Not a lot. That is surprising in Bangalore. Anyways, so there are a lot of people who are working in startups and a few people who are aspiring entrepreneurs. It is extremely important to build the right product. And to that context, minimum viable product is a product that is just those features that allow the product to be launched and no more. What this means is that, every time we have an idea or, we want to build something, we get very passionate about it and we get very sentimental about it. And there are 100 different things that you want to do. Believe me, even today I have got 100 ideas for Redbus that I left 6 months back that are still not implemented, right? And you can imagine how many ideas I have for FreeCharge. But it is very important to actually prioritize and pick only the few ones that are viable enough for it to be launched. So a minimum viable product has just those features that allow the product to be launched and no more. And this is a framework that people usually follow for a MVP. It's called the Build, Measure, Learn framework. So you have a hypothesis or an idea, right? That you think that if you do something, XYZ number of people will find it useful and XYZ number of people will use it. And hence you build it. When you build the product, you measure it based on your tracking and instrumentation that you have done. And you get a lot of data using which you learn and then you refine your idea. And this is a typical MVP framework that people follow. But the problem is building is expensive. Building a product is not very easy. It takes time, it takes effort, and it takes engineer's bandwidth, which is usually the most blocked up resource in a startup. Everything else is available, but building is really very expensive. So how do we build the right product? How do we increase the chances of success? Because every time we put an effort, how can I increase my chances to hit a home run or make it a successful product? Sorry. So I'm proposing a different MVP. I'm saying let's not build a minimum viable product, but let's build a minimum valuable product. Please don't mistake it with least valuable product. It is a minimum valuable product. So how can I build a product that is valuable to the customer in the least amount of resources that is available to me in the least amount of time that I'm going to put on this product? Your idea is your first MVP, right? So a minimum viable, like I said, it's a least number of features that is required to take the website live, right? The idea that you have to build a product or a feature that you want to incrementally include in your product, your idea is your first MVP. You need to validate it, right? You need to validate whether your idea will work in the market or not. I've seen a lot of entrepreneurs who failed because they have not spoken to the customers or not really validated their idea. They think their idea is wonderful. They talk to a few friends, they talk to a few people in their family and they say, oh wow, this is awesome and I'll go and make it live. There was one gentleman that I met a few weeks back and he built a product for surgeons. And he built that product for around 6 months. It used to manage surgeon appointments and all of all of the things that are required by a surgeon. I asked him, and he wound it up in 8 months. Then I asked him, why did you do that? Did you talk to any customers? He said, yeah, I spoke to around eight surgeons. And I asked him, how many of them were not your family members? He said, one. So he spoke to seven people, because he comes from a surgeon family. He spoke to seven people who are also all from his own family. And hence, sometimes the real insight gets missed out. But one way to validate your idea is go and talk to as many customers as possible. Talk to as many customers as possible, but go where your customers are currently doing what your product is proposing to do. Now, if at Redbus, because we were selling bus tickets, we used to spend a lot of time at the boarding points, because boarding points are where the bus customers are there, and that is where they buy the tickets. So we should spend a lot of time at the boarding points to actually talk to the customers, to understand what are the problems and whether in any way we can solve the problem. I'll give you some examples of what we did, but along with this. Don't ask the customers what they want. It is very easy for us to get 10 to 12 or 10 or 15 customers in a room and ask them, hey, what do you want? And you'll get a list of 100 different things, because customers don't know what they want. They will tell you, I want this, I want this, I want this, I want this. It is like you go and have Gujarati thali, right? You want to have everything. But if you ask them, acha, would you like this or do you like this, they would probably have a different answer. So one way of doing that is, you actually propose a solution to them. Say, hey, you have a problem, and if I give you this solution, and see how the customers react to it. That is a very good way of understanding whether your idea or product or feature will work for your customers or not. At Redbus, when we went to the boarding point, one of the main issues that we found was that a lot of customers have trouble finding boarding points. So, how many people have traveled by bus? Almost everyone. Awesome. Redbus is, that is why, it had a multi-million exit. So anyway, how many people have boarded Madiwala, a bus from Madiwala? Awesome. Super. So, and I'm sure a lot of times you guys would have a problem on where should I stand in Madiwala? Should I stand next to Sharma bus stand? Or should I stand next to KPN bus stand? There is absolutely no idea, because the address that you have given is next to some SBI bank ATM on some road, right? What really happens is at that time customers are very hyper, because the bus is usually delayed and it's not on time and they don't know what to stand. Then they start asking questions like, has the bus gone? Am I really standing in the right place or not? So this was the problem that we found out when we went to the customers, right? When we actually talked to them on the phone or just send them a survey, said that my experience was bad. But you will not get that kind of deep insights on what part of their experience was bad unless you go to the place where they're experiencing it and then try to find out. We solved that by actually taking photos. I'm not sure if you guys have checked this feature on Redbus, but we took photos of around 200 different boarding points in Bangalore along with GPS location. And this information is available to you at the time of boarding on your mobile application. You can actually map your route to the boarding point. You can also download the photos, and you can see how do you reach the boarding point. In fact, it was one of the one of the reasons why people who use the feature actually had a higher retention rate. So we figured that out in Redbus. So some of these features are driven by very, very deep customer insights. Also, when you're talking to your customers, ask them what will make them switch, right? They're doing some things that they're currently doing, and usually they don't have a problem with doing that. They really don't have a reason to use your cool, awesome, kick-ass product, because what they're doing is actually working for them. But what is it that will make them switch, right? Why did people switch from Hotmail to Yahoo to Gmail? Why will people switch from Orkut to Facebook or MySpace to Facebook? Why will people switch from YouTube to some other kick-ass new product that launches, right? The switching cost and the switching barrier is something that we as product managers and we as developers have to understand. In my case, in FreeCharge, a customer buying at a neighborhood Kirana store is very happy. He knows him. Wo jaake bolega, yaar, mere ko 20 rupees ka recharge de, he gets it. What is it that I can offer him which will make him switch, stop buying from the Kirana store and buy online, right? Those are the questions that you need to ask your customers, and those are the questions that you need answered. Switching cost. Few other ways of validating your idea is you know, put up a Google AdWord before you build anything, before you line a single line of code, right? Put up a Google AdWord. Advertise it for maybe 500 rupees a day. But you'll at least know how many people are clicking on that ad. You can validate by seeing how many searches are happening to that for that keyword and how many people are clicking on it. And even before you actually build a line of code, you get validation of your idea. We did this for a few features at FreeChart, where we randomly put up some ads for features that were still being thought of, right? This is a great way of getting first-hand user validation. Landing pages. I'm not sure if you guys have heard about the Dropbox story. So when Dropbox was launched, even before, I'm sorry, I missed the name of the co-founder, but even before he launched, he actually put out a video out there, which showed his, which showed a demo Dropbox. It basically showed how Dropbox works, right? And he got a crazy amount of views, right? Even before he actually built something, he got validation. Okay, this is something that people are looking for. This is something that has a market. So let me go ahead and build it. That's a great way of prioritizing your time and putting your time behind the stuff that is actually important. Send an email. Send an email to your customers. If you're building a SaaS service, send an email to all the people who are there in various corporates and ask them whether this solves their problem. Or tell them, okay, I'll solve your problem. Give me, give me all dump of the data and I'll solve it and send it to you. But email is a great way of validating your idea. You can send it to your friends. You can send it to your family. You can send it to your network. You can send it to your networks and just find out, hey, am I thinking in the right direction? Am I really trying to solve a problem that is really there? A button to nowhere. If you are in a decent sized organization, like let's say Redbus, FreeCharge, or BookMyShow, a lot of times you can just put a button saying that, hey, check out my new cool kick-ass awesome feature, and see how many people click on it. Right? For example, if we before we launched Turbo, now we had a lot of validation that Turbo will work, but before we launched Turbo, if we actually put up a button saying that turbocharge your transactions, click here, that would have given me an idea, okay, so many people might actually do it. That means this will be the revenue impact. And hence, I can actually put 2 weeks or 3 weeks in it, right? So button to nowhere. Just put up a button and see how many people click on it. Video mockups. I gave you an example of Dropbox. Video mockups are also a great way of validating your idea, because it puts across your idea in a much, much better way to the customer. And he can actually sense, okay, this is how my product might work. And this is a framework that I usually follow when I am prioritizing my features or when I am actually thinking of launching the next product, right? On the y-axis, you have an ability to do something, and on the x-axis you have perceived value. How many people here are MBA graduates or people who have done MBA? Okay, so you are very familiar with the 2x2 matrix, and surprise, we are going to target top right, right? Because that is where you want to focus, where you have very, very high perceived value from customers, and you have the ability to do something unique. If you find yourself in this bottom right segment, which is you have a very high perceived value, but very low ability to do unique, you will find yourself fighting on price. And very classic example here is Flipkart, Jabong, Myntra, and all the other 1,000 e-commerce sites that are currently there on the web in the Indian market, right? Anything that has a lot of competition, you will actually fight on price. If you are building an incremental MVP, right? Anybody who is here just should stop existing. I mean, if you are low, you don't have any ability and there is no market, you should just stop it. And there are examples for that products also, which I'll probably not give here. So this is a good framework to actually understand what's happening, right? Like I was mentioning, if there is a lot of competition in the segment that you want to operate in, the only way you can compete is price. But there is another way that you can disrupt the market. Right now, if there are a lot of players in the market, if the segment that you are operating in has a lot of competition, to create an MVP or to launch something is very difficult. Can you really think of an MVP for email now? I mean, think of the features that you'll have to fit in, think of the development time that you'll have to spend on building an email product that will displace Gmail. It sounds next to impossible, right? But it is very possible that you can disrupt email. You can disrupt the way people communicate, you can disrupt the way people send emails, and that is what happens when you enter in a crowded market. You disrupt. You don't incrementally create another MVP, right? And there are a lot of examples of disruption, right? Twitter is essentially an instant management, sorry, it started off as an IM tool, right? But it has evolved into something else, but they disrupted it that way. And there are tons of examples where people have disrupted. I'm really sorry, I'm feeling under the weather. And don't be stuck up on your idea. Don't be hesitant to change your idea as soon as possible or as frequently as possible. Ideas are cheap. It does not matter. It does not matter if you think you have the best idea in the world. It does not matter. Execution is what matters. So change your idea as frequently as possible. As soon as you get validation from the market, as soon as you get validation from your customers, you should change your idea. There is no point in being stuck up on your idea because you thought about it. But it is very important to not change your vision. And this is a very, very subtle difference between a vision and an idea. Your vision is to probably change the world. And your current idea is just one part of it. To give you another analogy of Red Bus, our vision was to actually disrupt bus travel in the country and make bus journey a very, very happy experience for the customer. So when we entered the market in 2007, a bus experience was horrendous in the country. Buses were bad, people were not focused on bus quality, and experiences were very, very bad. People were upset. And that was our vision. Putting up a website was an idea that could have changed because if there were not enough customers validating that idea. But the vision should not change. Because the vision is what drives you, the vision is what drives your product, and the vision is what will drive your team. So don't change your vision. The what can change, but don't change the why. Why you're doing stuff should not change. Sorry. And validate the market. This is also a very, very important point, I mean, to a lot of entrepreneurs and people who are working in startups. If there is no market out there, if there are people who are not going to buy it, there is no point in doing it. And again, there are a lot of ideas where, you know, I have put out two or three products in my spare time which had zero people buying it, right? Not 0.07, not 0.5, zero people. And that is because we did not validate the market, right? Validate the market. And right, and today, in today's days, it is very, very easy to validate how many people are looking for the product that you're building. Go to trends.google.com. Look at the keywords and see how is it trending, right? Go to Twitter. Search for some keywords and see how many people are looking for it. In fact, I'll give you an example. How many people here know about a site called Wishburg? Does anybody know about Wishburg? Quite, okay, a few. So Wishburg is a product that allows you to make a wish list. And the co-founder is a very good friend of mine called Praveen. And he told me that, you know, hey, Rajesh, you know how I validated my idea? I went onto Twitter and I searched for hashtag wish and saw how many people are actually tweeting a wish on Twitter, right? Basically, they are online and they are wishing something. And he said, hey, that sounded like an interesting number for me to work on a product like that. And there are not enough people over there. And today they are getting decent traction. I think they have over 1 million wishes now. And, you know, they validated the market like that. A lot of times when you reach a stage where you're doing decent enough and you have a lot of traction, you will always have this question. Hey, are we a global product or are we a local product? Right? Should I actually think of building it for the world, and should I actually think for building it for only my country or my city? And I'll give you a very good way to differentiate this. If you are building a product that is completely online, that means that has no offline presence or has no offline fulfillment channel, it is a global product. And examples of that are Wingify, Viral Mint, WebEngage, Facebook, Twitter, Gmail. All of these are global products because there is no offline fulfillment channels. But look at the other hand, the local startups that are famous in the country, that are popular in the country, are getting good traction. Sites like Redbus, BookMyShow, FreeCharge, Flipkart, Flipkart and, a lot of other sites which has an offline fulfillment channel. Any idea or any product that has an offline fulfillment channel, it is extremely difficult for us to go global. Because every market is difficult, every market is different, it has different consumer needs, it has different consumer experience. So it is extremely difficult for any offline fulfillment channel kind of idea to go global. But anything that is completely online, WebEngage is a very good example, right? Started off 3 years back and is a global product. So what do you do next? You have validated your idea. You have validated if you have a market. And then you have validated, okay, hey, you know, there is a business out here. I think people will use my feature. I think people will use my product. Start wireframing it. But don't get into the Don't go to Google and search for, hey, what are the best wireframing tools available for me? Because that is what I did, right? That is both a waste of your time and also a waste of precious bandwidth, especially when you work in startups. So, take a piece of paper, take a pencil and write it up and draw your customer flow. Draw a wireframe on the paper. And this is the best wireframing tool, believe me. I mean, I've used everything right from, pencil to Photoshop to PowerPoint to this. In fact, as at Redbus, we hired our first designer who's sitting here in 2012. We hired our first designer in 2012, and we've been active for around 5 years. I used to design in Photoshop. In PowerPoint. I used to design in PowerPoint. So Redbus, which is known for its user experience and user design and everything, was designed by a product manager and few people before me in PowerPoint. So don't get stuck in, hey, I'll make a cool looking website, because that is not what people are looking for. UX is greater than UI. And always remember that. UX is user experience, right? And design is not how it looks, but how it works for the customer. So it does not matter if you don't have access to brilliant tools. It does not matter if you don't know how to use Photoshop. It does not matter. But focus on the flow. And it can be done on a piece of paper. It can be done on PowerPoint. It can be done on Word. There is absolutely no denying that, right? And now you have done a wireframe. What do you do next? Target a specific segment. And I can't focus enough on this. Every time you have an idea, or you're building a product, or you have an idea for a feature, you think that, oh, everybody will use this. Everybody will not use it. Right? Your idea might be specific for a few set of audience, for a segment of audience. And target that segment first. So to give you an example, the turbo that you saw, that Harish actually demoed, right? That was targeted for a very, very small audience. People who have repeat, who have already done a repeat transaction. People who have credits. People who have money lying with us, right? That was a segment. Now that was actually further, the first part of the launch was people who have done a repeat transaction. And then who are logged in. So start off with a small segment. Then it will go to the next segment, which is, people who have money. The next segment would be saved cards. The segment after that would be people who do multiple transactions a day. But start at a small segment. What will help you is that, A, it will help you focus on one thing. Okay, I'm trying to move this metric. I'm trying to impact this. And it will help you measure data to the right extent. So target a specific segment. And do hard prioritization. Like I said at the beginning of the slide, right? You will get 1,000 ideas. You will get 50,000 ideas. Trust me. But do hard prioritization. And a very good analogy of a jigsaw puzzle, right? If you solve a jigsaw puzzle, you have to start with the corners. Because that is the easiest, right? You know, okay, this goes in the left corner, this goes in the right. You can't start at the center. You will never finish, you will finish it, but it will take you longer to finish the jigsaw puzzle rather than if you had started at the corner, right? So do hard prioritization. Cut off everything. Do you guys remember when first, and this is a very classic example, but I'm sure you guys remember when the first iPhone was launched, it did not have cut, copy, paste. In fact, Mac does not have cut even now, right? So some of the features you can cut off, because maybe the customers think it is important, but if you think it is going to take a lot of time for you to reach there, remove those features. Don't focus on those features at all. Do hard prioritization. And hence be focused on doing one thing right. And don't be afraid to chop off things. Always be focused on doing one single thing. I mean, whatever idea, whatever feature, whatever product that you're building, what is the one thing that you're trying to do? Are you trying to sell airline tickets? Are you trying to have a kick-ass video watching experience for the customer? Are you trying to build a social network where you want people to talk to each other? Do one thing, whatever it is. And slowly you can build on top of it. But be focused on doing only one thing right. And after you've done all of those things, you've done wireframe, you've done segmentation, you've decided that you are doing one thing, it's time for beta launch, right? So, you launch a beta version, which is probably behind the login. Yeah, beta ho to aisa. Yeah. So, you launch a beta version where it is behind a login only. It is only invite. You can do various kind of things. It's a special URL that is shared with only friends and family. But it is very, very important to have that first initial set of customers. Just play around with your product and look for major bugs. And that is the way I treat it. Because most of the times you are so involved in your product and your project that some of the most obvious bugs are invisible to you. you tend to miss out on those. So we launch in beta and then share it with your friends and family. And don't be afraid of data. Data is your friend. Instrument right from day one onwards. Instrument every single thing, right from mouse hovers to mouse clicks to anything that you can think of, to time spent, to where is the customer coming from. You might not be using a lot of it right now, but you might need to use it, probably 2 months down the line, and you'll think, "Arey, what about my past data?" So don't do that. If you are building a product, I mean, as front-end engineers or as product managers or as engineers, think of what are all the different instrumentation cases that you can do, right? Instrument everything. And at FreeCharge, we do a lot of instrumentation, to be honest, and it has given us a lot of insights. One example is, just skip my mind, but it always gives you very, very insight, very, very deep insights that you can actually use. One very good example is, the sorting logic that we have applied on the coupons page. So, FreeCharge basically offers free recharges. So you do a recharge for 100 rupees and you get coupons that you, and you get discounts worth 100 that you can pick. Now we have implemented a logic that actually takes into consideration the coupon sorting order that the customer has seen, what are the coupons that the customer is clicking, and his past history to actually show him a better coupon rate the next time that he comes, right? Now that is what we're trying to do. But if we had not instrumented this in the first place, I would have probably not be able to do it, right? Data is your friend. Once you get the feedback, attack what is broken and change what doesn't work. And don't be afraid to go back and do thousands of iterations. And taking from what Hari said, right? If you remember, he said the first version did not work. It did not work because the data that we were trying to, the metric that we were trying to move did not move, right? The impact that we were trying to have for that website, it was not there. So you do the next version. If you don't see that impact, do the third version. But keep doing it. Attack what is broken and change what doesn't work. In fact, after we launched the new website, we saw a drop in our conversion rate. But because we had instrumented it, to a certain extent, we were able to fix it very, very quickly and bring it back to the levels that it was previously. And now it is definitely much better than what it was of the old version. So, instrument everything. And also, as an aside, I would like to talk a little about what are the metrics that are important for you to track, right? Now, what really happens is that when you get access to a lot of data, you get boggled down, you get bogged down by it. Because there is access to so much, you can look at this metric, you can look at that, you can look at this. But try to have not more than 3 metrics, right? In anything that you do, 3 is the maximum number of metrics that you should have. At FreeCharge, we look at conversion rate, we look at the average revenue per transaction, and then we look at repeat user transaction. These are the 3 metrics that we have, right? And everything else is a sub-metric of this. So bounce rate, number of people who click on that button, number of people who pick the coupon, everything else is a submetric of these large 3 metrics, right? So don't get bogged down by data. Look at 1 or 2 important metrics. And also look at the funnel that you're trying to impact, right? Usually what happens is, once the product gets a little complex, you have multiple funnels. The customer can do this also, can do this also, can do that also. Try to avoid that. Have one single funnel. Try to have one single metric that you're trying to impact, right? And hopefully you have done all of these things and you're ready for a launch, right? You finally launched your product, which is Hrithik Roshan in this case. And we are hopefully get a lot of insights and, you're good to go. Now, once you have launched your MVP, right? Now we have reached to the MVP stage that, okay, I've done a whole lot of background. I've talked to customers. I figured out what is my segment. I figured out what is the market. Now, you are launched. Now, what do you do next? And here is another framework that I propose and that I, typically use when I'm thinking of features, right? On the top left is your core value prop. So, your core value proposition is your core offering of your product because of which you attract customers, right? In case of FreeCharge, it is free recharge. In case of Redbus, it is bus tickets. In case of BookMyShow, it is movie tickets. In case of Flipkart, it is online product, right? So every product has a core value prop, right? And that induces trials, right? Customers come to your site because there is a core value prop that you have validated by your customer. So now that you are out in the market, people see, okay, this is something that actually is solving my problem. So I'll come and I'll use them, right? And that is what induces trial, which is based on your core value prop. Once the customer tries your product out, right, you need to have good hygiene and experience. Let's say if you buy a product from Flipkart and the product is not delivered to you, there are very less chances that you will actually go back. Or let's say if you buy a bus ticket from Redbus, if the bus was bad, you will not go back because your experience was bad, because the hygiene was not good enough, right? So the core value prop induces trials for first-time customers, which then, because of good hygiene and experience, induces repeat usage, right? So he has a consistently good experience. Whenever he comes, he gets what he wants. On free charge, if he is looking for recharge, that is the main thing that I should focus on, that every time the customer comes, he gets what he wants. If he wants 100 rupees recharge, he gets 100 rupees recharge. Over consistent period of time, right, when he does a lot of repeat usages, you can build intelligence and personalization on top of it. Another example is, if I know that a customer comes every time and does a recharge for 20 rupees, right? Turbo was an example of that. I am actually helping him reduce the time taken for him to do a recharge, right? And that actually induces loyalty. Because once I'm hooked onto your product, you're essentially barring me from going anywhere else, right? If invested enough into your product, I'll not go to some other version of the same product that is available out there, right? And I touched upon, you know, investment. And that's a very, very important point. Make the customer invest in your product every time he transacts with you. 10 minutes? Okay. So, and there are various different kind of investments, right? I'll give you, and these are some of the investments that the customer can make in you, right? There is time, there is money, there is personal brand, and there is emotional investment. Every time you give your email ID out to someone, you're investing your personal brand into Gmail. Every time you go and upload a photo, you're investing your emotions to Facebook, right? And this is a whole big topic altogether, but I'm just touching on it here. You go to YouTube because you're bored, right? That is an emotional investment that you've done in YouTube, because you're going to YouTube to be entertained. A study shows that when you are lonely, you check more email, right? That is the emotional investment that you are doing into email, right? Every time you put up you upload a photo on Facebook, you are getting invested into Facebook. Every time you add a friend, because your relationship with the product is increasing, right? And there are various kind of investments that you can make your product do. Time, money, personal brand, and emotional. One is the time that you spend with you, right? In a lot of SaaS products, my company has spent a lot of time with this product, so I'll not move, because there is a lot of history that is involved. Second is the investment that he's doing to which saves his time. Turbo is an example of that. If he is saving his details of his recharge or of his number of his recharge account, his saved cards, he's investing in my product, that is reducing his time, right? That is the investment that he does. Emotional investment. Every time you give your customer a wow experience, you know, because of a excellent product experience, let's say because of the copy and content that you have, right? You are talking to the customer emotionally, right? And that is the emotional investment that the customer does. Think of all the various ways where you can make the customer invest in your product. And it could be anything, right? From a click to storing something to saving something to a repeat experience, right? Think of experience. And going forward, don't forget to experiment. I mean, even after so many years, right, I don't know shit. I don't know what will work for the customer, to be very honest. I don't know. So experiment everything. You don't know whether this will work. In this case, the left side poster might definitely work in Bangalore, right? Or in any other city. You don't know that. You really don't know that. So experiment everything that you can experiment. And this will only be possible if you have a strong instrumentation and you know what data to track. So it is all in relation with that. But remember to experiment everything. And I just want to leave you with two things. Always remember that the customers don't buy your product. They buy a better version of themselves. Right? So in case of Mario, you're not buying the small Mario, but you're buying the supercharged mushroom eaten Mario. Right? And always keep that in mind. Customer is not buying your product. He's buying a better version of himself. Right? So this is something that I generally like. And Eric Ries, always mentions this, that entrepreneurship is startup is really a series of MVP. So even after a 3-year-old product, Recharge has been around for 3 years, we are still in an MVP stage. And we are still discussing what is our next MVP. At Redbus, we still we still did the same thing, right? What is our next MVP? This is always a series of MVP, and I don't know when it ends, to be very honest. I don't know at what stage I can say that, okay, now I'm locked in MVP, now I'll have a big release cycle and stuff like that, right? I honestly don't know the answer. I would say that it is always a smaller MVP. And taking some inspiration from Harish. I tweeted Parsi and my email ID is Rajesh. Feedback is very important for me. Right? There is.
Is Vijayakant the brand ambassador for
Vijayakant is the brand? No. It's in the power of Vijayakant. Vijayakant, you might want to answer.
So, in one of the slides, you were suggesting that we do things like put up a Google ad or have a button to nowhere and things like that, right? So a parallel thought is that you get only one chance to delight your customer. So how do you compare that to if you put a button to nowhere and he gets the impression that you always put a button to nowhere? Isn't that a brand preface?
Hello.
Yeah.
So, we have seen this in the past where you share an idea with the customer of something that exists, that does not exist, right? But that just exists in thought. Some of the customers are excited about the fact that, okay, something like that, like this might be existing in the future, right? And there are a lot of examples of that. Google Glass, when it is launched, it is not really available for the domain, right? But it is available to a certain set of customers to experience it and to see it, which is exactly a similar thing, right? They are validating the idea. They don't know whether Google Glass will work or not, but they validated it for a long time, right? So some of those things you need to target the visionary customers. But usually I've seen that it does not really create a problem.
So in case of Google Glass, the product actually existed. So I thought what you were talking about is
it existed, but when they first demoed it. Right. When they first demoed it, it was, two and a half or three years back. When it was still in the beta stage. Right. So at that time, it is always good to validate. And it is not something like Google Ad or another button. You don't have to keep on your website for a long time. Right. Even if you keep it for 2 or 3 hours, you get that kind of feedback. And it is better than building something that nobody wants than showing something that people want and it is not there. Right. So that is the trade-off that you'll have to make. How much time do we have? So two more questions.
Is it good to give access of MVP to limited sets of users, or it's better to release publicly?
No, absolutely. I mean, I think it is always better to set it out to a limited set of audience that you know set in the target segment that you are trying to target, right? So it is always good to have a limited set of audience because you will get targeted feedback. And then you can work on it and then increase it to more number of audience. So we typically, whenever we do a new launch, we launch it to 1% of the customers. So that means less than 0.5% of the customers actually see. We take the feedback, we see what are they saying, how are they behaving, how are they impacting the metrics, and then we slowly move to 5, 10, 50, 100%. That is how we usually launch at feature.
Okay.
Right.
My question is about the disruptive strategy point that you mentioned.
Right.
So, years back when FreeCharge started, that time it was a very new market, but today there are a lot of players, some of them doing very well in terms of UX. Paytm is one example.
Right.
So when you redid the UX, what was the disruptive strategy around,
Yeah, unfortunately, I can't talk a lot about it, but be rest assured that we are going to disrupt that market. We are going to come up with something that is really, really exciting and very valuable to the customer, but unfortunately it is still under wraps. But we are disrupting the market, and a lot of these things are actually in line with that. So it is not that, अरे यार मेरे को नया सेट चाहिए चलो redesign करते हैं. It's not like that, right? A lot of this was in line with the strategy कि अच्छा what is it that we want to do next? How do we differentiate ourselves from the competition and how can we make ourselves more valuable to the customers? Right? That was the thought. So maybe in few months time you'll be able to see. Last question. One last question. Okay, cool. I will have an extra cup of coffee there. Oh, sorry. There's somebody.
When we are putting our MVPs on for feedback purposes.
I'm sorry, could you be a little louder?
When we are putting our any idea for a trial purpose, maybe through emails or maybe Twitter or anything, is it wise that we give our ideas publicly because our competitors can come up with the same idea and develop a product?
So if I go back to the slide, right, ideas are cheap, man. Ideas don't matter. I mean, trust me, it is not the idea that is important, it is the execution. I can be sitting on the next $1 billion idea and talk to 20 different guys about it. But if I know that I'll be able to execute it in a much better way than anybody else, then ideas really don't matter. It is okay if your ideas are out there in the open. It is actually okay, right? It does not matter. So, it's about that. Okay, I think we are done. Thank you so much, guys. It was wonderful talking here. Thank you so much.